Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. And though it be a cross that raises me, still all my soul shall be nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Though like the wanderer the sun go down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone, yet in my dream I be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. There let the way appear, steps unto heaven, all that thou sendest me in mercy given, angels to beckon me nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Then with my waking thoughts bright with thy praise, out of my stormy griefs, Bethel I'll raise. So by my woes to be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Though dim be the lighthouse and dark sea and sky, with Christ at the helm every gale we endure. For Jesus the Savior is my pilot sure. I nothing can fear, I nothing can dread, for Jesus keeps watch here, and by him I'm led. My seas may be rough, but when voyages are past, my haven of hope will be heaven at last. Though tempest may threaten the craft and the crew, and why get the jaws of the deep for me too? With Christ at the oar, I am safe in his will. And Jesus the Savior is my pilot still. I nothing can fear, I nothing can dread, for Jesus keeps watch here, and by him I'm led. My seas may be rough, but when voyages are past, my haven of hope will be heaven at last. If Jesus but speak to this voice of great power, The billows must sleep and be still from that hour. And I at the brightness of dawning shall be with Jesus my pilot safe over the sea. I nothing can fear, I nothing can dread, for Jesus keeps watch here, and by him I'm led. My seas may be rough, but when voyages are past, my haven of hope will be heaven at last. Yes, Father, we put our hope in you, Lord. For you guide us, you lead us, you lead us down the path that is straight. You lead us through the storm, Lord. You lead us through the gale. You lead us through our struggle. You also lead us through our joys, Father. Father, I lift up this time in worship, this time in praise, this time in coming into your word to learn truth and to grow on your truth. And in your truth. We falter, we stray because we live in this fallen world, Lord. The tempter constantly tempts our hearts to turn from you. But yet, Father, we want to stay nearer to you, nearer to all that you have for us. We put our trust in your hand, we put our very lives in your hand, because you are our pilot. You are our helmsman that leads us through the trial that is the life we lead here. Father, bless this time we have. Bless this opportunity in your word to learn more of your truth, more of the way we need to live our life, more of the way we are guided by your word and led by your spirit. Father, watch over us in this new day, the new week that is before us. And allow us to be, Lord, your witness to the unsaved world, to the unbeliever, that your grace is offered to all, that your forgiveness is offered to all. All this I ask, all this I lift up in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's turn to a familiar book in the Old Testament, the book of Jonah. And we will cover the entire book of Jonah, the four chapters, but we will not read the verses, we will just cover the entire book. And as a believer in Christ, all of us should be familiar with this book. The story of Jonah is a familiar one, not only to Christians throughout the ages, but to the world as a whole. Many stories about this story have been told in literature as well as in the movies. The story is one of love, of grace and mercy, a story that transcends cultures and nations. Here's our God, who is filled with love and mercy for all men, calling his prophet, Jonah, to preach to a pagan nation to repent of their wicked ways, to repent of their sins. How easily it would have been if Jonah just simply obeyed God's calling. But that is not the case in this book of Jonah. The book of Jonah does not say much about the Ninevites, but another prophet, Nahum, does. And what he mentions is a city of people who are totally wicked, who are totally depraved,
totally against God. Nineveh was guilty of evil schemes and plots against God. They exploited the helpless. They were cruel in warfare. They reveled in idolatry, prostitution, and witchcraft. They were a people very far from God, to say the least. They were pagans. The city of Nineveh was an old city since the time of Nimrod, before even of Abraham. It was located some 500 miles to the north of Israel. It was one of Assyria's royal cities, and it served as its capital. This city exerted great influence in that region and was possibly the largest city in the ancient world. The wall surrounding the inner city itself stretched some 8 miles long. The rest of the city and area occupied some 60 miles in total. And the population may have been about 600,000. Very large city for that time, even today. But, like Sodom and Gomorrah, the wickedness of Nineveh had come up to God. God had seen their depravity. He had seen their sin, and it was great. God saw just how debased, depraved, and sinful the Ninevites were, and he could have easily wiped them off the earth if he chose to do that. He saw their sin, and he could have easily punished them right then. The Ninevites worshipped a fish goddess, and they worshipped Dagon, the fish god, who is depicted as half man and half fish. God in his mercy, God in his grace, wanted to save the city, although they were sinners, although they rebelled against him. And this is where we meet the prophet Jonah. God tells Jonah to go to the city and cry against it, cry out to it. But what we see is something we have never seen in Scripture. We see a prophet of God do the total opposite of what God told him to do. He rejected God's call and fled in the opposite direction. He refused to heed God's command. He turns and wanted to flee to this city called Tarshish, a city possibly located in southern Spain. And this is as far west as he could have gone. Jonah had grown up and experienced the evil and the atrocities that the Assyrians had done. He hated them so much that he refused God's command to go to the Ninevites. Jonah's action actually showed just how reluctant the Israelites were in sharing God's love and mercy to others, even though this was God's given mission to the Israelites. Jonah, like all Israelites, did not want Gentiles, the Ninevites, to receive the favor of God. And so we see Jonah going down to Joppa, a seaport. He found a ship that was going to Tarshish. He paid the fare, and he wanted to get as far away from God as he could, or at least he believed he could. Now, as you look at it, who can truly flee from God? Jonah believed, and he tried to do it. But God had other plans for Jonah. The ship set out, but a storm hit the ship. And the sailors who were used to storms on the sea were afraid because this storm was not an ordinary one. The ship and its passengers were in dire straits, so that the sailors prayed to whatever god they worshipped. They even threw over their precious cargo to lighten it because the ship was being torn apart. And where is Jonah in all of this? What is he doing? Jonah was no sailor, and he could care less about a storm on the sea. So he goes into the belly of the ship and goes to sleep. You will kind of question, how can he sleep in such a storm? The ship now is in peril. The captain of the ship wakens Jonah and tells him to pray to his God. Maybe, just maybe, he will answer your prayer and save the ship and save us. No prayer, no God answered. So the sailors have one last resort. They cast lots to see why they were in this situation, why they were in this plight. And in casting their lot, the lot and the guilt fell on Jonah. Jonah tells the crew that he is a Hebrew. And through the conversation, the crew knows that Jonah is running from God. And they become very afraid. What do we do then? Jonah tells them to throw him over. Throw him into the sea. At first, the crew tried all that they could to get back to land. But the storm was too great, too violent. And although pagans, they had concern for Jonah, but their efforts were in vain. Finally, exhausted, they called on the true God of heaven, not to let them perish because of Jonah's disobedience. They were innocent of their actions. Then they threw Jonah over, and then the great storm stopped. The crew, remember, who were pagans and not Israelites, feared God. They offered sacrifice and made vows to God. And this is a God they had never knew, never worshipped. And they did it because of a disobedient prophet. Now we go to the part of the book of Jonah where the story goes to Jonah and the whale, or Jonah and the fish, or the great fish that swallowed Jonah. Scripture did not say it was a whale, though. It just says it was a great fish, a fish prepared by God. And God chosen this great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah spent 3 days and 3 nights in its belly. It was in the belly of the fish that Jonah finally submitted to the will of God. At this point, there was nothing Jonah could do but submit. After all, God is in control. Jonah tried to run away, but God redirected him. Jonah contemplated, and he prayed in the belly of the fish, until finally God tells the fish to vomit Jonah up onto dry land. God told Jonah to go to Nineveh once again. He tells him to do what he should have done before. Go to the Ninevites. How easy it would have been if Jonah heeded God's command the first time. It would have saved him much grief, much trial, and much discomfort. We all should notice that God gave Jonah a second chance because he could have punished his prophet for disobeying him. Jonah accepts God's command and he goes to Nineveh. As I mentioned before, Nineveh was probably the largest city of the ancient world at that time in history. The city proper and its surrounding area probably encompassed some 60 miles in total and would have required Jonah 3 days just to get around it. Walking just about 1 day, though, Jonah tells the Ninevites that their city will be overthrown. It will be destroyed in 40 days. Jonah's experience with the great fish and the Ninevites' pagan beliefs instantly gained him access to the people. And what do we see from the pagan Ninevites? They instantly, immediately repented. They did not need to think about it. The whole city repented. Even the king of Nineveh put aside his royal robes and put on sackcloth and ashes, showing his repentance. He made a proclamation that all his people, to even include the animals, to not eat and not drink. All must be covered in sackcloth, and all men call on God, and that all men turn from their evil and wicked ways. Maybe, just maybe, God may change his mind and not destroy the city and our people. God's word, God's love is for everyone, not just for the select, not just for the few. Even though they were wicked, the Ninevites were open to God's message and repented instantly. And this is the dark contrast to the stubbornness of Israel. Israel had heard countless messages from God's prophets, but they still refused to repent. They refused to turn back to God. The Ninevites, the pagans, only needed one message, and they repented. Jesus Christ said it himself, that at the judgment, the people of Nineveh will stand up to condemn Israel for their failure to repent. God saw the repentance of the Ninevites, and he relented and chose not to overthrow or destroy the city. Now imagine in today's world that one city does repent. The entire population repents. Is that even thinkable? Nineveh did it here in the Old Testament. God showed mercy and did not punish them, even though they would have deserved God's wrath because they were sinners, vile and wicked. And like all sinners, the Ninevites repented of their ways, and God forgave them. That is how simple as it gets. All you need to do is turn from your sin, repent of your sin, and turn to God, and he will forgive you. It would have been great if the story of Jonah just ended here, with the repentance of an entire city. But no, It would seem that Jonah himself was still lost in his hatred of the Ninevites. The repentance of an entire city just did not sit well with Jonah. He did not want them to be forgiven. He wanted them to be destroyed, eliminated. The Israelites, and later the Jews, wanted God all to themselves. They did not want to share him with any pagans or any Gentiles. Yet God's purpose in the beginning was to have his chosen people, the Israelites, to be a blessing for the rest of the world as they shared God's message with other nations and other peoples. Jonah did not want the Ninevites to be saved. He did not want God to show mercy to the evil and wicked. And this was the true reason as to why Jonah wanted to run away and not share God's message of grace. Because he knew God is a God of mercy and grace. No matter what people you come from, what culture you come from, Jonah wanted to die. He could not take it that God so easily forgave the enemies of Israel. And God tells Jonah, "Do you have good reason to be angry?" Jonah then goes to the east of the city, builds a shelter for him, and waits to see what will happen to the city. Maybe he believed that God will destroy the city. God made a plant to grow over Jonah, and it provided shade for him against the scorching heat of the day. This made Jonah happy. Somehow, saving an entire city does not make him happy, but a plant does. But God made a worm, and it attacked the plant, and it withered, and it died. When the heat came in the day, there was no plant to shade him. So Jonah begged God to allow him to die. Again, God tells Jonah, "Do you have good reason to be angry, even to death?" And Jonah tells God he has good reason to be angry, even to death. Then God says, "You had compassion on the plant for which you did not work and which you did not cause to grow, which came up overnight and perished overnight. Should I not have compassion on Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know the difference between their right and left hand, as well as many animals?" God loves the world, be it Gentile or be you Jew. God loved the Ninevites because they were part of his creation. God's love is far removed from the indifference and hatred that Jonah showed. Jonah showed more compassion and concern for a simple plant than he had for the Ninevites, which showed just how warped his thinking truly was. If Lot could have found at least 10 righteous people in Sodom and Gomorrah, God would have spared it. In this great city of Nineveh, with an estimated population of 600,000 people, God did not destroy it because they repented of their evil ways. This is the greatest repentance ever in the history of the world. Just with one message, an entire city changed its ways, turned to the true God of heaven, and served him. God ministered to Jonah, He ministered to the Ninevites, and he will minister to you and to me. When we obey his will, he leads us. When we truly ask for forgiveness, he will forgive us. If we continue our rebellious acts against him, his punishment will be severe. His examples are right before us. He saved an entire city because they repented, but he destroyed two other cities because not even 10 righteous could be found in them. This is a lesson we take from the book of Jonah. God is merciful, even when we want to run from God. Even though we may be the most sinful and wicked, when you repent and turn from your sins, God forgives. Amen.
The dream that I dream of my Savior divine, and I know that my dream will come true. At the morning, the night comes the vision of life with the promise eternally. Oh, this wonderful dream is the secret of grace, and I would that this secret you knew. For I dream that last I shall look on his face, and I know that my dream will come true. There's a sweet compensation for heartache and loss in the hope that is given to me. I shall quickly forget how the road was beset when the King in his beauty I see. Oh, this wonderful dream is a secret of grace, and I would that this secret you knew. For I dream that last I shall look on his face, and I know that my dream will come true. He will still be my stay when the passions of earth in the midst are dissolving away. For the passage of death will be only a breath, but a breath and my dream will come true. Oh, this wonderful dream is the secret of grace, and I would that this secret you knew. For I dream that last I shall look on his face, and I know that my dream will come true.
Father, we thank you for the story of Jonah, for in it we learn of not only your mercy and your grace, but also that you show mercy and grace to even those who turn so easily from your command and your will. You show grace to those who want to be forgiven, who want to turn from their sins, who repent of their ways. We saw that in the story. But you also show grace to your prophet, who wanted to get away from you because he did not want to show your mercy to another nation, a nation he hated. Father, we ask that Today, your mercy be shown to many, because many reject you. Many have turned from you. Many rebel against you, Lord. And we ask, Lord, that you will change the heart of many that do that today. For there are countless that are lost in sin and relish in their sin. They cherish the sin they live in, the wickedness that they do. But even in that, Lord, you still love the sinner. And you will, and you offer your grace to the person that is ignorant of you or have turned from you. We pray, Lord, that you will open the heart of that person, open the life of that person, so that they realize they are sinners, they have missed your mark, they have fallen away from you, Lord, and they want to come back to you, want to be forgiven of their sin, want to be washed of their sin, want to come back to be with you, Lord. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.